people online who were going to the same convention who were all dressing up from the same anime that I was. And of course, I want pictures with this character and that character. And so, you know, all right, Saturday, 2 p.m. is going to be a police, you know, gathering. Let's all go out.
It was always a fountain.
Yeah, and that, like, this massive female internet communication between all the fandoms and people dressing up and everything was how I made most of my friends, because you're dressing from the same show, so clearly we have a mutual interest, and I now love you. But over the years, for me, I didn't need to go to those meetups, because now I talk with the people on the side, and they were my friends, and I really didn't need conventions either to meet up with them or get photos or anything, because half my friends would be photographers, the other half would be cosplayers, and we just meet up on our separate times. But really, hands down, it is the conventions where cosplayers are meeting in mass to get together and have those, like, all DC photo shoots, all Superman, every version photo shoots.
It was, like, for me, I cosplayed a lot when I was in high school, and then I kind of had this, like, period where I just, like, stopped cosplaying for a while. And I think that I was in college and I had to, like,
I didn't have a car to go anywhere, and I was, like, it didn't make sense at the time. And then I graduated from college and came out here, and there was this, like, sometimes like that, but there was this like void in my life where I had nothing that was inspiring me. I had nothing going for me that I was passionate about. I was unemployed, I was bored, I was like, what am I doing with my life? And a friend of mine was like, well, just and like sent me to the fabric store and was like, go make something you've always wanted to do. Just do something to get you off of the sofa. And I don't even know. I made King Rocket costumes for me and my boyfriend.
Yep.
And I made it with one of those little, like, cans. Yeah, I had no idea what I was doing. I had never made anything on my own because my mom made all my costumes for me in high school. So I was like, all right, I guess this looks like kind of, it'll
hold together.
It was the most uncomfortable thing I've ever worn in my entire life. But I loved doing it. I had so much fun doing it. So then, like, getting back into the convention scene and the cosplay scene and, like, seeing how dramatically it changed from what I was used to in high school, there were so many more people doing it and so many more, like, series of fandoms and stuff that were, like, acceptable to wear to different conventions and stuff. And I was, like, so overwhelmed and just went to a convention. I was, like, before this. And I had random people would, like, come up to me and are you going to the this meetup later? Are you, oh my gosh, I love your costume, are you going to this meetup? And it just like all of a sudden I was like, similar interests to me. And I made a ton of friends that way. Like even just like I went to Kamikaze last year and I was dressed as the Dark Phoenix because the costume I've always wanted.
social anxiety, and I compensate for it by being like loud and boisterous and ridiculous. But at a con is the one place where I don't feel that way. Like, yeah. At a con, I'm like, okay, I'm among my people. Like, we're good, you know? But, like, a little bit. Like, I go to a bar, and I'm like, I'm so out of what? Yeah. These people and there's alcohol here, I don't understand what's going on. Like,
I have a running joke with my friends that I'm more myself in a costume than I am in my normal clothes. Like, as soon as I put on the spandex suit or, you know, Disney princess dress or whatever, I'm like, my energy just comes out. And my friends even, they'll notice it when we're going to a convention, and I'll put on the costume, and all of a sudden I'm a totally different person. And they're like,
we make it. Do you have any plans to go to Asia or Europe for cosplay overseas?
Cosplay is actually very different overseas, especially in Japan, although places like Germany and Russia are amazing, like, cosplayers. Like, we think in America we know what, like, cosplay is, but, like, the quality of production of costumes in European countries is just, it drives it phenomenal. But, like, actually in Japan, like, it is
not acceptable.
It is, but within very confined, like, rules and spaces. Like, for us, it's, you know, well, they just have so many interesting and weird things going on there, obviously Lolita and other stuff like that, and their fashions and trends are so kind of bizarre and all over the place, but actually for the Black City and Two, the name is a big connection there, but, like, the, hey, do you remember?
Comic-Con.
Is where some of the most amazing cosplay pictures will come from, and for the friends that I've had go there, you are not allowed to be in your costume when you get there. You actually have to change there in an open changing room. You have like 15 minutes to change, and you're in a tiny little square that you're allowed to change into. And then you're taken outside to the roof, and you're only allowed to stay in one certain little spot while photographers take photos of you. And that is not what we do here, at all. But it is a very structured and strict, confined, experience, and it's not where it's our American concept of a convention, which is we're all a bunch of geeks flooding into a hall. Some of us are industry professionals, some of us are just hobbyists, some of us are in costumes, some of us aren't, but you're all in the same space, and it's a shared community space. Like, that's not the cosplay that's, like, presented over in Japan, even though some of the costumes are made in Japan, like, their societal structure is so different from ours.
Yeah.
Like, I thought I wanted to go over there, but I was like, no, I'm fine. Staying
I would like
here.
To visit Tokyo, but I don't think I'd want to go overseas for a con, unless, like, I was being paid by
that
con.
Another thing that I think a lot of people don't really realize is how much money we invest.
Oh, yeah.
How much money
do
you invest?
A lot. My mom's actually, just 50 bucks.
Yeah,
like anyone else.
I have
kept an Excel sheet budget. I did it for a couple classes to see what happened. I would put in, like, you know, what I thought something would cost and then break it down. But very few of my costumes have been cost less than $500 when I get to it at the end of the day.
I've spent
$1,000 to $2,000 on some. There was a back room like stages ago, and that was $2,000. But you know, because you're not dropping it all at once,
yeah.
It's like
yeah.
A little slow bleed out of you, you know?
You're just hemorrhaging money.
Yeah.
It's like buying an old car.
Yeah.
Sort of,
like,
yeah.
A good wig might cost you $50 depending on the length of quality. For doing lace front, might be.
You learn real quick what a good wig looks like, depending, you know.
Needs
are shoes
cost anywhere from $30 to $100. The fabric, I mean, actually for my Jean Grey, like, the wig cost like $50, but, like, spandex was not as expensive. Actually, I lied. But I didn't need that much of it,
because
it was fine.
If you're moving out of LA, you have the fabric difference, so we can get
exactly.
Like, my costumes in high school, I went to Disneyland. Even, like, my Star Wars
costume
that I made when I started back up.
When
I was, like, right back in
your
face, you're like, oh, God, you poor child. I didn't know any better.
You don't know
if I was terrified. I didn't want
to
go downtown. I had no freaking choice.
I had to go to Joanne's.
Right, you got no choice. And, I mean, at Joanne's, I'd drop dollars on fabric for a skirt.
Like,
not even
the
light.
I used
to work at Joanne's.
Barely
took a discount.
Yeah.
I never got that much. I think my most recent costume was Lady Malfia from Lost Unicorn, and I'm doing the comic book version, and I only spent $35 on all of the fabric, all of the trim.
Mm-hmm.
That is freaking it. The wig, however, did cost $70.
Yeah, so the wig cost
super long.
So
it really depends, again, if you're doing what you consider accurate, or if you're doing it for fun. fun because what you might do for fun, you might go to like a dollar bin business category in Joann's or whatever, spend $5 or $10. If you'll pay any price for the fabric you believe is perfect, like, or the actual movie fabric or best represents the comic drawing, it could be, you know, $5 a yard, $6 a yard.
That's what my fiance does.
We've done fabric, custom fabric printing, which used to be unheard of back in the day, and it's a whole new game changer for a lot of cosplayers now. Like, the first time I did, like, a custom fabric, it was before that was common.
Like, so no way!
He actually designed the pattern in Photoshop and then did iron-on transfer, and I iron-on transferred an entire jacket. Whereas now, I think I can get it printed as fabric for $30 a yard, which is not that bad.
Yeah. I mean, people, when I made my husband's Captain America costume, I had people messaging me and emailing me saying, can you make me one? And I was like, yes, but I'm not going to tell you what it costs because you're not going to want to pay it. And I know at least, you know, a couple of us have been approached by people saying, like, well, I want to commission this thing. And I'm like, listen, I'd be happy to make it for you, but people don't want to pay what it's going to... They don't understand that, like, buying a costume on eBay is totally different from having one made custom. But part of what I've enjoyed about sort of working in, like, film and stuff is they understand, like, how much these things cost and the time that they take to do. And so they're like, okay, you know, work with the constraints that you have. Like, I understand what your time and money is worth.
Some of them.
You know, the people who really talk to you about that are the steampunk. They are like the experts at, like, this is a lamp and, like, a hairdryer that I made into a ray gun. Like,
I would definitely say that over the years, people that work at places like Home Depot have noticed an increase of just what they would probably consider weirdos who don't look home improvement type in the store. Because a place like Home Depot is just a freaking gold mine to, because what you want to make, you know, the artist makes something that does not exist in the real world, and now we have to make it in reality because that's what we do to work ourselves that way. So you're like, all right, that doesn't exist. I need to make it. I'm going to try to make it out of physical objects and build from there. And so it requires you to get innovative and go to Home Depot, other places like that. You know, you might find PVC pipe, a hair dryer, a from an old camera, you know. I mean, Star Wars was built on...
Oh, yeah. The
ridiculous stuff that, like, should never be together, and they all flown together. It's one of the most beautiful things you've ever seen. But I know, like, I collected parts for the Vibro Act, and one of that... What is it, babe? It's a...
Hair dryer, blow restrictor.
Just things you have to go on Depot for anyway, but I mean, just are bizarre, and I want to do the Green Lantern Jade from the Omni Home version
She's got
headphones on, but they're in the shape of the lantern, and so I already know, like, in my head, like, I need to go to Home Depot, because I know I can probably find the shape I need that I can glue together to then make a mold and attach the actual headphones I want, but, like, you...
My idea was to cast them in clear resin, but put LEDs inside so they light up.
Exactly.
Yeah. I wanted to add on to that. The costume you'll see me wearing when I change later on is Black Widow, from, like, the comic book version of Black Widow. And the little widow strings and the belt are all made out of wood. Like, the widow strings are dowel rods that have been cut and drilled and spray painted, and the belt is also, like, little wooden circles out of the craft store, like, A-plus cheap craftsmanship. That I painted with spray paint.
Well, and the lace layers for the, you know, X-Wing pilot, the things that are on the legs, those are wood dowel rod. Jedi palettes from the prequels are a very specific style of pen cap. So it's actually really interesting, like, how, at least for movie costumes, they just use found normal products, painted them a certain color, or stuck one new thing onto it. And it became this, Jetta Communicators are a female razor.
Gillette razor.
It's a Gillette razor painted, and they took the razor part off. I love that one.
The little meter they used to detect ghosts in Ghostbusters is actually like a thing for Chinese shoes.
Yeah. So it's like interesting to like learn that about costume designers in movies, because I think it helps for us to one replicate non-existent costumes, things that are only drawn, because like all right, like how would a movie costume or TV costume designer like make this in real life? There must be a way with existing materials that might be too. Sculpted by hand, but we will sculpt it by hand.
Actually, you keep getting around this again. You go on and make everything from scratch, but you're in LA, and I know that there's places that have that sell costume parts, like Western costume and all that.
Yeah,
you guys ever find anything useful in it?
Those costumes, they're so expensive.
Even when they're getting rid of them?
And B, in a way, well, if you go to Western costumes, they're beyond expensive. But, like, I mean, you can go to, like, the auctions where they're selling actual parts from TV shows.
Yeah, it depends if you want the actual real costume, which some people totally do, but if you can't afford it or you want
to. And part of the fun of it is, like, how can I make this ridiculous thing happen? Like, you get to play MacGyver for a while, and you're like, I'm going to make this
like some string. Part of what really connects me to the characters in cosplay is the blood, sweat, and tears that I put into making the costume. Because I've bought costumes before, and I've done ones, you know, like back when I first started, where I just found stuff from a thrift store and threw it together and whatever, and it's just, there's a certain disconnect that's there for me that I don't feel so connected to that costume as I do when I look at something that I've made myself, and I can go, wow, I really put a lot of time and effort into this. I really love this character. I love the way that this looks, and I'm really proud to take it out and put it out there for people.
And nobody will mention
it. Exactly. You can put your own little twist on it and stuff. And
like going to the store buying a prom dress. No one at that dance is going to have the same dress.
Are there any characters where you know you want to do it, but you've never been able to quite figure out how to get it to work?
Absolutely. I really want to do Cortana from Halo.
If you guys have played the Halo game.
And she's essentially, she's made of code, right? Yeah. So when you look at her, she's sort of transparent, and she has this like scrolling lines of code running over her body. You're like, how the hell?
Yeah, how do I make you
like, I'm like, I could put yellow wire in a suit and make it look kind of cool, and I was like, well, what if it's UV reactive, and it glows in black light, and still, like, it's not going to move, you know? No?
Mine was Emma Frost, but I can't remember who did it. I think it was Nicole Marie Jean, actually. I wanted to do half of my body in the diamond form.
Yeah.
And she figured out how to do it, and I was like, no! But it's so cool that she did it, and it looks really good, and I always thought it'd be really neat to have the contact with it. So one eye was white, and the other one.
I also really want to do the Ame Kome version of Raven. Have you seen her? And her cape is basically made of
Her cape is insane.
Her cape is made of demon faces, right?
I want to do the Justice Raven. I will not do the Ame Kome, right?
Made of demon faces. Like, where am I supposed to find that demon?
No, you're not, like, freaking out
all my family.
Come on now, right? Like, yeah. Sculpt those faces, and then it'll only look good from one angle, because it's not going to move, you know?
How often have you guys actually gone to... Because I've heard you've mentioned resin a couple of times. Have you guys tried, like, going to other classes or something to learn, like, cold
tattoos? I can't afford the classes, but I have money on the factory.
A lot of it is, and you know, there are really good forums. There's the replica prop forum and the superhero costume forum, and both of those are really good resources where people will share.
And
people will share, like, here's how you do this. They'll share their techniques and kind of things. So you can sort of learn organically that way.
But I'm, like, on the Reynolds newsletter, and I definitely want to take an actual, like, physical class in a building where, like, other people, like, have more of a, like, a physical hands-on approach. Mm-hmm. I can just ever afford, like, a class fee, like, a couple hundred, and I'd rather spend a couple hundred on this or something. But, like, my fiancé, I spend a lot of time, like, checking out the YouTube and RPM. I can't go on the RPM because I just buy things.
Right.
Can't do it. But I mean, that is how a lot of, I think, our community
that's how I learned about
styling is some friends was, you know, had the talent and knowledge of like casting and sculpting, so you could get a one-on-one from that person, or you'd go on YouTube, which brought everyone together.
Or you ask your friends for help.
Yeah.
I mean, you need a head cast made so you can sculpt some kind of like Vulcan forehead prosthetic.
Mm-hmm.
So you call up a friend who knows how to do that.
Yeah, and that's literally what happened. Like a friend of mine came over and did a head cast for me in our kitchen, and now I have a bust of my head with the sculpted things on to.
So you can kind of trade your skills with other
yeah.
people who, like maybe your friend who knows how to sculpt doesn't know how to sew, so you can help, you can trade back and forth and you can kind of collaborate.
I asked her if she can help me make a sculpt of my head because I know she's done that before. And she's like, would you have to move your head? I'm like, well, no, it's for a client on Etsy. She's like, so can you see any head?
I'm like,
yeah, I guess so. She's like, because I have a sculpt of my head in the other room.
I mean, okay.